Captain Haynes?
They keep telling me I'm supposed to make a statement, but they don't tell me what I'm supposed to say. And I'll tell you right now.
I don't think we need any scripts. I'm just going to turn it over to Captain Al Haynes, Bill Records, Jan Brown, and Susan White Callender. Thank you for coming.
And I have dry mouth, and so I have to take a sip every four words or I go through the sip. So bear with me. And it's going to be very brief. First of all, I'm very honored to be up here and to be back in Sioux City again. We all are. That's all we can talk about is being back to Sioux City to thank all the people involved in our operation. The movie that they made about the thing was supposed to be called A Thousand Heroes, and that's the way I think it is. Our team started with the three of us in the cockpit, and then the flight attendants became part of the team, and then the controllers became part of the team, and that team grew into about 1,000 people here in Sioux City who responded to help us get through this as best we could. And to every single one of you, I want to say thank you. We're just very grateful for that and very happy to be back here, and I'm through. Next.
Your turn, Mouth.
Well, we're always happy to come to Sioux City. There were just so many terrific people here. It just leaves a warm spot in your heart to see so much of the goodness in the American spirit that they showed us. I mentioned earlier today to one of the interviewers that when my wife got here, for example, she saw people standing around the block and asked the driver what they were all doing there, and it was explained to her that they're waiting to donate blood. So it went like that. I was here for a month in the hospital, and I got all the reports pretty much secondhand from my wife, but they were all terrific. I had many good experiences. It all boils down to the wonderful people in Sioux City, in the Siouxland area. Thank you.
Everybody knows how I hate to speak.
You have to speak up, dear.
I know. The more fear I feel, the lower my voice goes. But I do have this opportunity, and what's in my heart is for this indomitable crew, this cockpit crew, for this valiant flying partners, for the wonderful passengers that our team, as Al said, our team grew because we were a team. And then we came to this wonderful Siouxland community, which in my mind it exemplifies the heartland, and I stress the word heart. This wonderful community that we were so blessed to have save us. And as one of my significant gospel passengers said, they clothed us, they visited us, they fed us. What more can I say but thank you? I just feel so much gratitude. And I also have to mention our crew member, Renee, who is one of our angels now, and our fourth pilot, Denny. So we remember those near and dear who are no longer with us, but they'll always be with us in our minds and hearts. And thank you.
You're up.
Hey. Hi. I'm a little nervous. It feels really good to be back in Sioux City 25 years later. I can't believe it's been 25 years, and I can't say enough good things about the people of Siouxland and what they did for us that day. We were so blessed to have an amazing cockpit crew to save our lives, and a great flight attendant crew all working together, and we had the best passengers that helped each other. It was just an incredible, incredible day of humanity. And then to come out of the airplane and have all these generous workers, responders, people from Siouxland helping and donating blood and offering their homes and rides and food. They were just so wonderful, and it's so good to be back here to say thank you to everyone in Siouxland area. We as a crew are just so blessed, and that we landed here, and so grateful. And we never forget those 112 that passed. They're always in our hearts and in our prayers. And we think about their families on this Memorial Weekend.
Okay, where's our moderator?
I think go ahead and ask questions of this group. We'll kind of change out the next group once kind of the group questions are over. The press has questions.
Kathy, could you talk a little bit about the fact that I know it was important for you to come back here for this 25th year, but you've also kept in contact with all of yourselves that have taken on an annual basis over these 25 years, and how close have you all remained since this? Obviously, having you here today speaks of that, but I take it you've all stayed in very close contact with each other.
You talking about the crew?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, the crew stayed very close. We've had, first 5 or 6 years, we had reunion every year. And then it's kind of hard for everybody who's working to get off at the same time. So we had to kind of stop that. But we had them when we can. And I think the last one we had was, where's Rosa? When's the last one we had? Was it 5 years ago? Was that the one in D.C.? Yeah, we had a 20-year in D.C. Not everybody was there because they couldn't all make it. But we try to stay in touch as much as we can. And I stay in touch with some of the passengers, which I'm very happy to say, too. In fact, there's one or two that are supposed to be here, and I don't see them, so I'll get on them. Yeah.
We stay in touch with Al fairly regularly, my wife and I, since Al lives relatively close to the airport. So whenever we go anywhere, we park in Al's driveway, and he drives. We catch up on all the latest that way.
Park and ride. They're cheap. They don't want to pay the parking fee. They get a free shuttle if I'm home, too. Who else?
Oh, there are several of us in Chicago, Rosa and Denny and Tim. And Tim always calls me about or emails me in September and asks when my Christmas party is because he loves to come over for the food.
For the one thing we want to stress that we didn't know each other when this happened. I had flown the month before with Bill. Everybody thinks the pilots all fly together. We don't. Bill and I happened to fly together the month before. That's the first time I'd ever met him. Our second flight was the first time I'd ever met Dudley. And so we didn't know each other. And I knew Jan. I had seen Jan on a flight, but I don't think I remember any of the other rest of the crew. So none of us knew each other. Of course, they'd been flying together, so they had. But the day, it was a four-day trip.
Yes.
And this was their first time they'd all flown together. So it's how quickly we all just became one unit, and that's because of 232 and the bonding that takes place. It's amazing how quickly it happens. So we've been very good friends and very close ever since.
Al, how many talks have you given?
How many talks? Yeah. I think I just did number 1,700.
Oh, my gosh. That's amazing. That's morning.
And I did 3 last month, but I'm off now in November. But I do it because I had a lot of trouble with guilt of survival. And Mike, the psychiatrist from Denver, and I talked about it a lot. And I said, I just can't figure out why I was allowed to survive and others weren't. And he said, it won't do you any good because you're never going to come up with an answer. Why me doesn't work, what if doesn't work, it happened. And you're going to have to accept it. And after a while, I said, well, maybe. I started doing these talks, and I said, maybe that's why I survived to do these talks. And he said, good, go with that. That's going to work. And I do. Every talk I give is a little step further to get over this. You know, you're never going to get over it. I don't believe in the word closure. You're never going to close out something like this. You just learn to accept it and to live with it. My wife died, I live with that. My son died, I live with that. My daughter had a bone marrow transplant, we live with that. But we talk about it, and that's what you have to do, is talk. And people won't want to talk about their troubles. Finally, they're finding out in the military that PTSD is only solved by talking. And my giving these talks brings that to mind to people, so that's why I do it.
To Al's credit, What money that he's received for these talks has all gone into scholarships that are associated with some of the survivors and various scholarships around the Siouxland area, mainly in the medical field. And most of the money, although everybody's contributed, the biggest percentages come from Al.
Nothing goes to me. I don't allow that. I don't think that's what I'm here for. I'm here to raise money to help other people. That's what I feel about it anyway. Nothing else? That's like my talks. I can finish my talk. Any questions? Nobody got a question. But the minute I leave the stage, whoop, you know, and everybody wants that. Why didn't you ask that? Well, I didn't feel like I should answer. So there's no bad questions and no stupid questions. Stupid answers, but no stupid questions. So. But they want to ask anyway. How many working? It's what, three?
There's four flight attendants that are still actively flying with United.
Four from 232 are still active?
Yes, yes.
Yeah. How many years
have you been? 28.
She was hired when she was three.
Thanks.
One of four.
Yes.
232 there. Well, no, Rosa. You talking about Rosa too?
No, that was
on the flight? What for? Are you? Which four are still working? You and Tim?
Donna. And Kathy.
And Kathy, okay. And then Rosa, who was Denny's wife.
Denny's.
She's a flight attendant.
Denny Fitch's wife.
Denny Fitch's wife, the captain of Canada. She's a flight attendant.
What sort of apprehension, Susan, did you have in subsequent flights in 1989 on forward? Did you?
Oh, it was very hard to go back to work. It was extremely hard. My dad asked me, he said, "You're not going to go back, are you?" And I said, "Of course I am. I loved my job, and I didn't want to quit, and I knew that going back would be the hardest hurdle I would ever have to jump over. And if I didn't go back, I would let so many things in life defeat me. And I'm glad I went back. But after about a year, I had a breakdown and ended up back in therapy. Because especially flying on the DC-10, I would see certain seats with passengers that I connected with, and it was really hard, extremely hard. And other flight attendants wanted to hear my story, and I never wanted to deny anyone that. So I would always talk about it, and then I'd go to my hotel room, and we'd have a short layover, and I'd be up late at night, and I'd say my prayers, and I'd pray for those who passed, and I just couldn't sleep. And then it would be the domino effect the next day. I would be tired, and someone would want to hear the story, and so it went on and on for a year, and then I finally just broke down. But it's all good now. Yes. Trauma. It was post-traumatic stress.
A lot of times on planes, the announcements that you give, and long-time travelers probably just zone out and they maybe aren't listening to you. Maybe first-time travelers are listening, but what do I do in this and this? What were you telling people as you were approaching Sioux City? What were you telling the passengers to be doing?
Go ahead. Jan was.
She was on the mic.
Jan was our first flight attendant.
Are you referring to our emergency prep?
Yeah, what were you?
We'll have to read it.
As you're coming back from Sterling.
Right.
What were you telling? What were you instructing them to do?
Well, my flying partners were standing in their positions. They have responsibility for a certain position. I had to read it right from the book, so it was basically covering having your seatbelt low and tight, stowing your belongings. I think we covered pens and pockets, things like that. Brace position. The bend over and grab your ankles type, and the alternate, which is to put your hands up against the seat back in front of you, which I have since always told people, and I retired in 98, but I'm still at it. Once a safety advocate, always a safety advocate, no matter what it takes to bend over and get as low as possible, because you'll survive the crash and get killed by the luggage coming out of the overhead compartments. When I was out in the cornfield assessing who was most seriously injured, so I'd know as soon as rescue workers came, I saw two men on the ground, an older man, a younger man, and I couldn't see what damage they had incurred to their heads. There was so much blood. But the minute I saw them, I knew that they had taken the alternate brace position and they must have been hit by the luggage coming out. The other egregious thing that's on that safety card now, to this day, 25 years later, nothing has been done about children under two being allowed to fly for free on their parents' lap, and therefore they're also free to fly through the cabin. I'm most concerned about them hurting themselves, but they're also going to hurt somebody else, and probably somebody who never wanted children. But on the safety card, it's criminal to show a parent holding an infant, and this is what they're recommending, hold it with one arm, when it's proven, even in the FAA test facility in Oklahoma City, that you can't hold them with two arms, and then they are bent over. That I call the crush position, because if you're going to whiplash in a collision, you're going to crush that child that you're holding with one arm if you're still holding them and it hasn't flown off. And then they're bracing with their other hand up against the seat back, which is a great target for the overhead luggage. So it's incredible. It was incredible and ludicrous that I was announcing, after having prepared all the passengers, that I was thinking, have I covered everything, and remembered that we had four lap children, and picked up the PA and announced to those parents with lap children to place them on the floor. Now, I was thinking, oh my gosh, well, way back in classroom situation, this sounds great. There's no fear or threat in a classroom. But when I'm telling somebody to put them on the floor in a situation that we're in, and I'm thinking to myself, and we should be hoping for the best, well, I faced the mother, and that's what I told her when she looked up at me and said she was trying to go back to the wreckage, and I stopped her. And she said, you told me to put my baby on the floor, it would be okay, and he's gone. And it was like, well, that's a turning point in my life, because I know that it wasn't the best thing that day, but as I told her, that was the best we had. That was the thing to do, it was the best we had. That's my clear message from up above, why I'm still here, and will continue to lobby for child restraints on airplanes so that flight attendants never have to face this situation again. And a parent never has to realize that just because it's allowed, it is safe when it absolutely isn't, and the FAA knows this. They put it on their website, but I'd like to know how many parents check the FAA website before they fly with a lap child. I would guarantee it's probably a handful out of 100 or more.
That was going to be my follow-up question. It's the FAA that has the authority on this, right?
They're responsible for aviation safety. Why am I and hundreds of other people, and one of the best recent examples are the Colden people, the non-survivable crash in Buffalo several years ago, who have been very, very proactive in changing safety rules. Why are we doing this when the FAA is the aviation safety agency that is being paid to do this? And why are they telling me, when I asked one of them, when will they mandate child seats? This was in 1999, and his response to me was, when there are enough deaths, how many will it take?
And she's been lobbying for 25 years, constantly about it.
God always picks a non-speaker to do this.
Got it.
He's not here to speak up for small children, and I'll be his voice as long as I have a voice.
records. since the days of the accident, we've come to learn that you were flying the plane that day. It was a manual procedure that helped get the plane to Sioux City. There's a lot of conversation in the industry right now that jets have become too automated. The pilots no longer know how to do the things that you did that day or would be challenged if put in that situation. Your thoughts on that? Do you have those concerns?
Well, I don't, because I know how qualified the pilots are to get where they are. But it's true, excuse me, that there's more what we call seat of the pants flying. We flew the airplane, we knew what it was going to do. Now it's punch some buttons to do what the computer says. And I think it's getting too automated. I don't know whether the new pilots coming in, the new cockpits they have, they're called glass cockpits. They've got screens on them. It's like playing a computer game. If they can handle the airplane like it should be handled in a case like this. But I assume they are. I mean, they're very well trained and all. But it still concerns me how automated these things are getting. It needs to be back to the pilot flying the airplane. That's the basic thing. And he was flying.
Yeah, I agree with that. The automation is good. It's terrific. But it leads to complacency if you're not careful and they don't have procedures to increase the flying, hand-type flying, without the flight director and all the gee-whiz stuff. But I flew from 727s with the airlines, where you really get some hands-on flying and you really get familiar with flying airplanes. And then you graduate up and you still progress into the glass cockpit airplanes, and you're flying. The problem is when you get the combination of a glass cockpit airplane and you're flying it for 14 hours and you only get one landing. So on a trip like that, I happened to be flying the Pacific when I retired on 747-400. And you fly all the way to Australia for 14 hours and all the way back for another 14 hours. You do that three times a month. That's one landing for you, one landing for the co-pilots you're flying with that month. And maybe, who knows who gets the other one. So the relief pilots get very little of it. Consequently, you get pretty rusty, making very few landings. Not to mention, you get very little discipline in really flying the airplane around in flexible conditions that require for flexible, little flexibility. So I think it's something that's a problem, but it can be addressed if the airline flight departments put up some type of procedures that mandate people get a little more hands-on flying.
I think they're doing it more now.
They
from
are.
What I've heard they're doing. We're not related with the training. I haven't been back to the training center in years, but I know the training has been changed some to allow a little more individual flying. At least I am hearing it. I hope so. So they're actually hand-flying the airplane more.
Problem they said couldn't happen.
I could punch him because his leg, but, but no, there weren't no buttons. No buttons.
With no hydraulics, nothing works in the autopilot department. The auto throttles, the autopilot, none of that works.
Nothing works, yeah. And our second officer, Dudley, he got back problems. He couldn't be here today. But he had a terrible time convincing our maintenance base of what our problem was. Because you can't lose all three hydraulics. And they kept telling him, you can't do that. And well, he said, well, I'm sorry, but, you know, here we are. And he finally got it through to him. But they couldn't help us either, so. Yes?
I have a question for Bill. When you're in that huddled mass of a cockpit at the end of the landing, I wanted to know what was in your mind as you were entangled in that web.
As I was being rescued, you mean?
Oh, but prior to that, what were your thoughts?
Well, you're hanging on trying to do the best you can just to land the airplane, first of all.
After you stopped.
Oh, after we stopped. I'd say I woke up from being unconscious momentarily, and I could see a fireman walking across the bean field in one of those big aluminum suits. And I realized as I woke up that I had survived and I was alive. Now I was just going to try to concentrate on remaining alive. And It's kind of a warm feeling when finally I saw the firemen coming over. I mentioned to somebody that I could see help coming, and then we started to little by little listen to the progression of digging us out of the pile. they started with hacksaws and cable cutters, went to the jaws of life, and then they ended up, the guard unit came over with a forklift and hoisted it off of us with chains, putting chains around it. And you're kind of in and out, partially in shock, I'm sure, just kind of drifting along listening to this operation, but yet still feeling a little positive effect, the fact that they're there to save you or rescue you.
Captain, how about your thoughts?
When we hit the ground, I went out. I didn't go through the crash. I don't remember anything about it. I woke up in the cockpit with Dudley talking to me, the second officer, and then...
We talked about Al not making it, as a matter of fact.
No, they thought I died.
We heard from Denny in the top of the pile, and Dudley and I were conversing back and forth a little bit. Dudley said, I think we lost Al. We hadn't heard from him for quite a while.
I was unconscious most of the time. I woke up as they were taking me out and passed out again. I woke up at the ambulance for just a second. Then I woke up in the emergency room. And then I woke up in my room with the doctor sewing me up. The rest of the time, I was in and out.
How about you, Jan?
Well, the minute we hit, I just thought, I can't believe. I knew Al told us it was going to be rough, but I could never have imagined. And I thought I saw a couple of overhead bins open up, and it was like, this is the last straw. After trying to look normal for 40 minutes and being beyond fright, I just passed out. I said, there's nothing I can do right now. I'm going to check out for a few minutes. And you could just hear that screeching metal and noises you've never heard before and you don't hope you never hear again. And then I felt that we were tipping, apparently, when we flipped over. I just definitely didn't want to do that because I'm not a roller coaster person. I'm really a wuss, just to get to the point. But I initially thought I was going to reach out and try to stop it or hold on, and the jump seat hasn't anything except a seat in the back, and I just went with it. I went into a very deep unconscious state, so I could no longer hear the noises or anything. I was completely aware of what was happening because now I'm thinking, oh, now on top of everything else, now I'm in fire. And it was very specific, so it was obviously in the role because it was this two-thirds of my body. And I think it was a blessing that I was unconscious because my head was down, so it only fried my hair. My hairdresser said, don't worry, I could take care of it. And just thought, well, this is it. This is how I'm going to go. And it was the most serene moment I've known in a lifetime. The fear was gone. There was no pain. It was just total acceptance and total serenity. Then the fire was gone, and we stopped. And I was, now I'm thinking, oh, my gosh, I'm still thinking. I'm still alive. So it was like, back to work. We're out of here. And I apparently wasn't conscious enough to rotate and release my seatbelt. It's a good thing because I would probably hit my head on the floor that had been the ceiling. But a passenger, I guess I felt, who did it for me, didn't realize it was going to fly off, and it apparently fell on him. I started feeling and seeing things again as soon as I was on my feet, opened my eyes. He said I was yelling, get out, but I don't remember saying anything.
Can I add one thing here? Bill and Dudley and Denny and I had an interview in Seattle on a radio, on a television show, and there was some, like here, a lot of laughing going on. And I told them during the break that I want to make one thing clear. We don't think there was ever anything funny about this at all. But you have to break the tension with humor. It's all you can do. And that's what we've been doing up here today. We're all very tense, we're all very emotional, and if we don't throw in a little line once in a while, it gets more than we can handle. So there's nothing, please don't think there's anything, none of us think there's anything funny about this. But we do a lot of laughing and a lot of joking because that's the only way we can get through it. So I hope you understand that.
Can we just ask Susan's thoughts, please?
At the stop, I couldn't believe I was alive because I basically prepared myself to die. And when we landed, it was the big ball of fire, and I calmly said to myself, I'm burning to death, this is how I'm gonna die. And then the battle started. Everything started flying around like a tornado in the plane and metal peeling apart. And I was knocking things out of the way. I had my hands up on my head and knocking metal and debris just to be in the survival mode, to stay alive. And all of a sudden, after it seemed like an eternity of tumbling, finally came to a rest, and I couldn't believe, I just thought, I'm alive, I couldn't believe it. And we are taught, we have commands that we say, release your seatbelts and get out, and I just went into the flight attendant mode of release your seatbelts and get out, and Donna, the other flight attendant with me on the other side, was yelling with me, and we just kept yelling, and I was looking around trying to find where the fire was because the fireball was right there, and I thought, where's the fire? We're gonna explode, we survived, this is finally, you know, we made it. And I had no idea that we were detached from the rest of the airplane, as being in the tail, facing aft, just had the two lavatories in front of me. And I was struggling getting my seatbelt unfastened as well. As I was looking around, not looking down at it, I was looking out to find where the fire was. And I was struggling, and I had a little bit of panic, and I looked down, and I found the way to release it. We have two different types of releases. And I held on to my harness, and I swung around, and that's when I saw the big hole that we were detached from the rest of the plane. And that was a very overwhelming feeling of grief immediately, just knowing that I didn't know what had happened to the rest of the airplane. And after coming out of the plane to see all the debris and bodies and luggage and pieces of the airplane everywhere, it was just, it hit me so hard, the survivor's guilt, when I asked a rescue worker what happened to the rest of the plane, and he told me it disintegrated. And then I asked about the cockpit, and they said they're gone, disintegrated. And so that was a very emotional feeling. Just, it's amazing how survivor's guilt hits you immediately. And that's how I felt.
Jan, where were you at on the plane again? Susan, you said you were in the tail.
Yes.
I was a two left, so I'm aft of first class in the galley and facing economy, facing coach.
Tim Owens.
Kathy Pam.
Georgia D'Agostino.
Barb Gillespie.
And Donna McGrath.
Over here.
Thank
Hey, Jan. Can I make a statement? When asked about the safety procedures, mm-hmm. when we boarded in Denver, mm-hmm. there were a lot of children on the flight. So this little voice on the phone said, all you big adults, show how to pay attention and let these little children understand the safety regulations. And you made all the people pay attention. So
I didn't know that.
That was off this trip.
Well, that was part of our teamwork.
Yeah.
And you became a team.
Yeah, it was great.
For myself, I was out for approximately 3 months.
And when I came back, if I was working on a DC-10, I just couldn't sit at the exact same seat. I sat at three left for 232. So for the remainder of the life of the DC-10 for United, I never sat in that seat again, but otherwise I was fine.
For me, I came back a year after the crash. Be honest, at that time I wasn't really ready physically, because emotionally, I don't know I was ready or not, because I do not recall any bit of the crash. So I did come back to fly for a few months, but those few months such a struggle for me physically more than emotionally. But later became both physically and emotionally. So after 4 months, I took a 3 years long leave. At those 3 years, I kind of did a lot of reconstructive surgeries on my body, on my leg mainly, to kind of regain my confidence. So now I am still working, but currently I'm on medical leave. So flying has been good so far. In terms of the fear, if I say I'm fear of flying, they will be lying because I do not remember. But whenever if we have any kind of emotional circumstances, such as I see passengers, they share that they are fear of flying, then I am just totally give them my total attention to them. I sit down with them. I tell them, I don't tell them about my experience, but I tell them how to calm themselves down, how to deal with the issues. So I'm happy to be here, basically. I tell them, you know, everything happens for a reason. And if you try to run away from it, you only get worse. You have to tell yourself, God is always with us. He will take care of the rest. Just have a faith. When it's not your time, no matter what, you're not gonna leave. Just like my case. Yeah.
Hi. The accident happened in July, and I came back in October. And I feel like the faith and family that I had helped a lot. And also the therapy sessions that we had at United, and my crew members were amazing, and that helped.
She also forgot to say her birthday was the next day. I was off approximately a year, maybe a little bit more, not much. And I have to say that my first trip back, I was greeted by my old cockpit crew and their wives. And that was a wonderful surprise.
I guess mine was, as I listened to my my friends and my co-partners, that progressively, if you look at the front, which in the beginning was Jan and were, and Susan and I was in the back, I only had 4 stitches in my head, and mine was progressively, like in December of that year, I didn't realize my left arm was immobile, and that means that the impact of me hitting the door made an injury that I didn't realize until later, until my doctor asked me to put my hand behind my back and I could not move it. So that means I came back in March or April of the following year because of that, they call it adhesive capillitis. That means they had to go through therapy. Mentally, I think that we never know what we have to put up with. I think experiences teaches us that we must enjoy life the best way we know how. We must appreciate each other as much as we can, and we must be thankful, because we never know the decision that he makes for us is something that we don't know. So we don't have those answers. But one thing that I had a choice is, like, if I had to go, you know, God is so good to us. And in my my life, that has really impacted me more severely the time that I did have the crash. And my walk with him became closer, because it says, if you was in a car, what would you do? Would you go back? Is it all about you, or is it all about, and it was right. I would go back. And then when I went back, the fear that I had with the RJs, the small aircraft, I would hyperventilate because of the closure, so I had to turn on the vent to get some air. So I like flying. I enjoyed my job. And another thing that I learned, I'd always tell the passengers that you never know when something's going to happen. So always be ever so mindful that don't take that safety as a very joyful manner, because it's something that you don't know what you might need, but always remember where you are and always take that as a very critical moment in your life. But we never know what we can do until we've been put in a situation. You guys are heroes, and we appreciate each and every one of you all, because we couldn't do what we could do if it wasn't for you all doing the things that you all do. So we appreciate all of you all, and we thank you all.
This is probably only funny to Bill and I, and I don't know if he remembers it, because we've all talked today about what we do remember and don't remember. But Al had mentioned the joking, and if it was, we weren't laughing about it, but you have to about some things. Well, I had a trip into Sioux City in the winter one day. It was after Bill had moved to the 737 captains. And I came in on that flight. Well, there was Bill. He was taking it out. And there had been a snowstorm here. And I think everybody was snowed in for a day or two. And as we got off, I was met by the other flight attendants and talking about what a long layover they had had in Sioux City. Bill looked at me and he says, "They don't know what a long layover in Sioux City is, do they?"
Do you remember that?
Since we're telling funny stories on Bill. I was told two stories about Bill. He had made a rather unusually not soft landing, and the flight attendant came up to complain, and Dudley turned to her and says, "Don't bitch. The last time he landed, he broke my ankle." And then a little bit later, another not better, nothing perfect landing, flight attendant came up and started to complain, and what was it you said? You said, I was going to tell you. That's what happens when you get to be my age. You forget the punchline. But anyway, he made another very wise remark about Sioux City. But that was very funny when Dudley turned and says, "Don't complain. The last time he did this, he broke my leg." So.
This is going to be something pretty funny to some of you. And since I was off-duty flight attendant that day, so my name was not... I was on the crew name list, but on the impact, during the impact, because impact was so severe, and then my uniform was already cut up and then sent to the emergency room. So I was Jane Doe for overnight. So my poor husband, he could not hear me, could not find me. First of all, the United did call him about my thing, but they did not know where I was about, so they just told him to wait until they get the most of the information. So he did flew here. He did fly here that night, and then he went to the college first, and he could not find me. And then the second is the St. Luke Hospital. He went there. He still could not find me, and then he waited until the next morning, around very early in the morning, and then finally the nurse came to him, told him that I think we found your wife according to your description. So he went to the ICU, saw this thing. He says, red from head to toe. He cannot tell it was me, and all of a sudden, he saw this very uniquely looking toe. And then... And he was so sure, that's her, that's Kathy. So that's always the very like a punchline for my sharing. And I always say that to people, just there's always sadness, things like this. We always find a lot of like a humorous in there. So that's one of my thing I like to talk about.
I'm Greg Clapper. I was a brand new chaplain in the, you want it closer, yes. I was a brand new chaplain in the Air National Guard. When the plane crashed, I was teaching a small college up the road at Lamar's, Iowa. And I've deployed, I just retired last year after 24 years in the Air National Guard. And I deployed 5 different times overseas after this experience, and I did learn a lot from this experience that I was able to apply. 3 of the deployments took me to the U.S. Army Hospital in Landstuhl, Germany, where they take the injured from Iraq and Afghanistan. And I served as the chaplain on the psychiatric ward there on 3 different occasions. And I would just, you can't summarize all of this experience and all of the learnings, but I would just say this. Every day on that psych ward, we'd have what they call a spiritual wellness group. And I would ask them 2 questions that were deeply informed by my experience after 232. When we get in a small group with these soldiers and sailors and Marines, airmen there from all groups, they were there because they had suffered terrible things in their history. And so at first I'd ask them, first question that has to do with freedom, I said, what do you want to be free from? And sometimes they'd start with the usual smart aleck answers like the army, or free from this ward, because it is a lockdown ward. But pretty quickly they got serious. They said, I'd like to be free from the nightmares, or the memories, or the anger. And so after people started getting real and sharing in that group on that first question, what do you want to be free from? Then I asked them a different question. What do you want to be free for? And very often you could feel the atmosphere change in the room. Because we get hung up sometimes. We think there's only one kind of freedom. What are you free from? But the other kind of freedom is to be free for something. And so some people would say, well, yeah, I do have 2 kids back home, and I want to be free for them. I remember one fellow from the Northeast, he worked cutting out granite, and he said, I'm also a sculptor, and I'd love to get back to that. And you could see his face light up. And I think that's one thing that's true for all of us, that we all have histories, and there are parts of those histories we want to be free from. But you know, as long as we're on Earth, there's still something we should be free for. And we can't just get hung up asking or get stuck on that point of, I want to be free from this. All right, no one's denying that. But now what do you want to be free for? And so working in the midst of all this brokenheartedness here helped me realize that. And, you know, humor has come up at a couple different points, and so I want to share one story. Didn't want to share it at first, especially after the right afterwards, but I think 25 years removed, it's safe. Because I want to give people who work in the helping profession, who are responders, permission to own the fact that, as Captain Haynes said, sometimes you need to laugh about things to get through them. Because that first night when I was walking the perimeter with the security policemen and the firefighters, I talked to a couple of responders, and they said, you know, when the plane crashed, I saw a man fly through the air. And this guy, you know, he was completely engaged. He risked his life to save lives and so forth. So he was there, and he was saying, I saw this man fly through the air. And right after that, I saw a set of golf clubs fly through the air. And he turned to his buddy, and his buddy said, well, I guess he was just playing through. Now, does that take away from the seriousness, or does that let you be a human being in the midst of it? And I think it lets you deal with it in a way that we humans deal with it. But it was a privilege to be there and work with people like Gary Brown, who made that disaster plan happen. And a lot of people lived because he forced them to practice. So
I made it crash.
No. You made the disaster plan in effect. Thank you.
I'm Gary Brown. I'm the director of Woodbury County Disaster and Emergency Services. Most of the local folks know me. Some of the out-of-town guests don't. I started with the county in 1981 with this department as a volunteer. Received several promotions along the way, and about 2 years prior to the crash, was promoted to the director of the department. Was at the airfield that day 25 years ago. Probably the number one, and I guess I have to say that, you know, I'm one person setting up here of several thousand that came out that day. So we had over 40 communities that participated in the response in this place we call Siouxland. Nobody's really ever said how far out that goes, but you started this. I think the number one question I've been asked over the years is the hero question, and I was asked that this morning about the crew. If I looked up to the crew as heroes, and I said, no, I kind of look at them like I do the rest of the people that were involved in this thing. They're rock stars. You know, they came, they lived together, they worked together, they played together, they walked through this journey together, and I don't think there's any heroes in this thing, but there's a lot of rock stars, and I just would say that the next time you bump into somebody in the medical profession, mental health profession, those people that take care of us every day, fire and EMS, they're rock stars. And they brought it together, and they played off an amazing concert that day. So military guys, everybody that was involved, take one person out of this equation, whether it's Kevin or myself or Al or anybody else in this room, you take one person out of this scenario, and the scenario plays out differently. And I don't think the outcome would have been good. So my hat's off to everybody that was involved in this thing. My hat's off to you guys, the survivors and family members, for coming back and spending some time with us too.
Good afternoon. My name's Kevin Bachman. I was the controller that was working the flight United 232. Worked at Sioux City from 1987 through June of 1990. And I left right before the first anniversary, because I had a little bit of a difficult time. I didn't really want to be here for the reunion and dredge up all those experiences again. This is my third time back in Sioux City, and I'm happy to be back again. Got to throw out here, that's my wife Pam and my daughter Francesca over there. They're traveling with me this time. The biggest things, takeaways for me from that event was, first of all, everybody did what we were trained to do, and that's the key thing. It wasn't just me in the tower. There were other air traffic controllers involved at the airport, relaying information to Gary's team. We were relaying information to Washington, to the national headquarters. Gary's team did their part. The flight crew did their part. I'll answer the first question right now. I still don't know how the heck they made it to the airport. I mean, that flight for 31 minutes, I imagined it was going to crash somewhere northeast. How they made, in my mind's eye, everyone was going to die. And the fact that they made it there was, I don't know, it was a miracle, essentially, because with what happened to that crippled aircraft, I still don't know how they did. But the fact is they did. And the fact that Captain Haynes and his flight crew got it there, allowed all the other professionals to do their jobs, and then all the volunteers to come forward, that's a big part of this story, too. The massive response from the community. The amount of time we had in while the plane was circling. Most traumatic events don't happen like that. Catastrophic event, it happens, the plane, something goes down quickly. We had time to organize. It was mind-boggling just the way everything played out just right. And it was hard for me working with the flight crew as they're coming inbound in my mind's eye, knowing they weren't going to make it, to all of a sudden seeing that it looked good. You know, we're in the tire cab, they're 15 miles northeast heading this way. They made one last turn up near the antenna farms up northeast of town. That's what really concerned me too, because you don't see the radar track because it dropped off because it was below radar coverage, but they made one more right 360 up there. And I was afraid that they were gonna hit the antennas up there and crash in that area. And the fact he made that turn and came inbound, it's like, oh my God, they're gonna make it. And it looked so good, coming in so fast on final. But It was just wide open. We just figured he was going to land, the gear was going to shear off, and everything was going to be okay. And yeah, to see what actually happened, it was very traumatizing. You know, I thought everybody had passed. The plane had disintegrated right in front of me. And yeah, it was tough. And to actually have so many survivors, to have the response we had, to have all the community help everyone out. I mean, it was a big part of the story. It's what made it happen. And the biggest takeaways I had from the entire event was, well, the biggest one is it really changed me. It changed who I was, because materialistic things no longer mattered to me, really. It's what you can do to help others. That's what defines who you are, because that's really, you're only as good as what you present yourself as. It's not about objects. It's about who we are. It's about what we do to help. We're all here together. And the Sioux Land community proved what they are. So with that, I'll let it go.
You know, I just got to say, there's a empty chair. Bob Hamilton was going to be up here, and he's not feeling well, so he went back home to rest for this evening. Several other people that could have been sitting in this chair that have gone on before us. Jim Hathaway. I could make a long list. Sherry Derby.
He was fire chief at the Air National.
Yeah, Jim Hathaway was the airport fire chief, the guy in the red suit that day. Sherry Derby, who was on our planning committee. Judy Glover, who was on the planning committee. There's a long list of people that were involved in the crash that have passed away and moved on. And there's several of them not feeling well right now. So they matter a lot to us. We miss them.
Please ask questions.
Kevin, what are you doing today?
Well, actually, when I left Sioux City, I transferred to a couple of different air traffic control facilities. Most of my career I spent at New York TRACON, working flights at either LaGuardia, radar approach control for LaGuardia and Kennedy. Newark. LaGuardia and Newark. I retired in 2006, and shortly thereafter, I got hired to with a company that developed flight procedures and redesigned airspace, basically modernizing airspace in terminal areas around airports, major airports. I did that for 3 years in Seattle, and after that work, I got hired by a company called MITRE-CASD, which is a Center for Advanced Aviation System Development out of Virginia. And what we do is, it's part of a next-gen initiative. Basically, all the automation out of them say they don't like, we're kind of implementing that.
I'll be your bodyguard the rest of this trip.
Well, one of the problems we've had in some of our designs and ongoing development in the system now is the crew is a major part of the flight crew management of the procedures is very important. So what we do is the design work we do, we've got the FAA involved, we've got industry involved, we've actually got line flight crew on these committees working as we're designing. So it's not one entity doing it. So we try to take everything into perspective, and we still have a little bit of a disconnect probably because you've got, like I say, the people from the industry working that might not have the exact amount of line experience. So we need to tap a little bit more into that. So I understand exactly what he's talking about, and we're trying to resolve to balance that issue out. But some of the procedures we develop nowadays, it's a lessons learned type activity. Because different automation systems for each aircraft, they're not the same. Different aircraft have different capabilities, and you're trying to make a system that works for all of them as best as you can. So it's not an easy task. So we take it slowly, we test it out, and then we have to modify to make it better. And that's how we learn, that's how we grow. And we take a lot of the cockpit input as we're developing these procedures both before and after they're designed, to see what issues they have. you know, if the pilot has to intervene, if the procedures aren't doing quite right, is there something we need to do differently that we try to bring that in into future designs? So it's all part of it. Because, I mean, you can have the best procedures in the world, but if the flight crews can't brief it and manage it, it's worthless. So.
Gary Hale talked about all the talks he's given since 1989, but you also, because of your preparedness plan way back then, you've also given your share of those. How many talks or how many airports have you been to as far as helping them implement a plan similar to what we had here in Sioux City? And how much of that have you done? I don't know if you even know the number, but you've done a lot of that too since.
No, I actually have not.
No, I mean Gary.
Oh, Gary. Okay, sorry.
You know, Woody, that brings up an interesting point. There's really four things that came out of the crash for us at the local level that we wanted to make sure happened. One was that we did a good job of documenting the lessons learned and sharing them with other communities. We really figured something good needed to come out of something so horrible for so many. So there have been, the number I've done, the number of Al's done is there, but we've had the different disciplines have traveled across the globe. They've been around the world talking about the lessons learned from the crash of Flight 232. And we've received a lot of feedback over the years from those communities that they heard the preparedness message from Al, from us, from the medical community, from the military. And they engaged their communities and they made their communities better and safer and better prepared. So I think that's one of the big steps that's come out of 232, that preparedness globally. I got a guy in Ohio and a guy in Washington State that have continued to communicate with me on almost a weekly basis about what they're doing with their systems. Number two, at the time of the crash, we're in a tri-state area. Three states came together to make this work. We had horrible communications between the responders. We literally had to have people running between us. We took that initiative when we created something called Starcom. We now have a joint radio system that covers the metro, the tri-state area. We wanted our responders to have better training. We built, we worked with the Siouxland Community Foundation, the crew, United Airlines. The Siouxland Foundation was started that created a place for people to donate and give money. The flight crew has given a lot of money. United Airlines put $600,000 in that fund. There are students all over this metro, all over the tri-state area that have received their education, or scholarships towards their education, and departments all over the tri-state area that have received grants from those, from the interest off of those dollars, coordinated by our Siouxland Community Foundation. Our community college obtained a $2 million grant. We've sent hundreds of responders through school with that money, all from the energy that the community received from the preparedness and the message of Flight 232. And then the crown jewel, so to speak, is a facility on the campus of Western Iowa Tech called the Security Institute. We now have a place for public safety to call home. It's where our 911 center is located, our emergency operations center is located, as well as our training facility for emergency responders. So, you know, I guess one of the messages that we want to make sure you all take back home with you, and that for those who lost loved ones in this crash and those of you whose lives were changed forever, we didn't just set back on the recognition the communities received. We took this thing and we made it better. You know, there's been a lot said about the magic of this preparedness thing and all of that. But really, looking back over 25 years, and there was a story in the Sioux City Journal the other day, there's a lot less magic, a lot less magic preparedness wand waved over this thing than there was. Take a look at what goes on in communities every day, how people help people. And that's what 232 is really a story of. 232 is a story of what we do every day as humanity is help people. Whether it's somebody with cancer and needs a fundraiser, whether it's somebody broke down along the highway. And I think that's the magic, that it all came together in one spot under the watchful eye of the national news media, and it was spread around the globe as some kind of a magic. It wasn't. It was what we do, and what we do every day. People have said, oh, our community can never do that. Yeah, I don't agree with that. I think most communities work together well every day and can pull it off.
And you know, this is a typical humble Midwesterner, and the local folks know this background, but some of the national folks may not. Gary saw to it that there was a disaster plan in place, and he had people out. He coordinated the fire department, the police, the county, the year before, and they had a drill almost at the same place that the plane ended up crashing. So yes, Midwestern spirit, everything you said is right, but it's also because of this horse's neck that stood in the door and said, we will have a plan, we will prepare, and it was there, and everyone is in your debt.
Yeah. It's really about the matter. You and I have debated this before. You need to quit talking about this. No, it really is. You know, it was kind of interesting because it really came together for me here just recently. I had a relative that was dying of cancer, and they did a fundraiser for her. And this person worked at McDonald's. 700 people showed up for somebody that worked at McDonald's, you know. A couple thousand people showed up for 296 of you that we'd never met. You know, it took what goes on every day in this community, in the United States, and it brought it all in one spot, in one time, under the watchful eye of the national media, and the world saw things differently, so.